are a driven people. We work hard. We value accomplishment. We teach our children that they can be anything and have anything if they will work hard. We are an ambitious people. But our ambition has a dark side. Sometimes we work so hard that we exclude people we love. Sometimes we tie our identity so intimately to our work that we feel we no longer have any value when we are no longer able to do that work. And sometimes we take that spirit of hard work and achievement and apply it to our relationship with God, a relationship that God will insist is purely by grace. Which brings us to the parable in today's gospel lesson. A king has a son who's getting married, and the king's going to host the reception. The king sends out invitations, and when the time for the party to begin arrives, he sends out his slaves to let those folks know that the party is about to begin. It's time to come to the party. But they don't come. So he sends out another group of servants with a ramped up message this time. Look. I've gone to a lot of trouble and a lot of expense to get ready for this wedding reception, and you are my loyal subjects, and I want you to be here, to be part of the celebration. It's time to begin the party. You must come. And in response, he gets nothing but excuses. But this king is determined that there's going to be a wedding reception. And so when his invited guests don't show up, he goes out to find those who will show up. He tells his slave, you go to that place where you will find the most people, and you invite anyone you see. Yep, anyone. Anyone you see. I don't even care whether they're good or bad. I want my banquet hall full. See, this king is determined to have a party. That's the one thing that I love about this story. The king is a stand-in for God. God is determined that he's going to have a party. See, I don't know where the church ever got the idea that in God's kingdom, some are in and some are out, some are worthy and some aren't. What I hear over and over again in the teachings of Jesus and in the stories of Jesus and in all over the New Testament is that all are invited. God wants everyone to know God's love. God wants everyone to live in God's love. God wants everyone to live in the fullness of the life that God intended. God's kingdom is defined by God's rich, unfathomable, unquenchable love and grace. And here's the deal. To get into this party, you don't have to do a bloody thing, only get invited. And by the time we get to the end of the story, everyone has been invited. The good and the bad. The rich and the poor. The ones you expect to get an invitation and the ones you don't expect to get an invitation. Everyone is invited. But it seems that some have excuses for not attending the party. Too busy. Too much going on. Not interested, doesn't sound like much fun. I just don't give a hoot or a holler. Mr. King, you can go jump in a lake because I got stuff to do. And it makes me wonder then, how we demonstrate our own indifference to God's invitation. An invitation to a lavish banquet of love and mercy and grace. What things are we too busy with to bother with God or the work of God's kingdom? What are the ways that we make light of God's call or trivialize it or put it on the back burner? Because, you see, there's a warning about putting it on the back burner. The king ordered those non-attendees to be murdered and their cities burned. That is harsh. And you see what the harshest judgment is directed at? Indifference. Apathy. The notion that anything is more important than the banquet of the kingdom. Now I get it. We do important things. We do. We have jobs and we raise children. We love to go boating or biking or make things in our shop. And as I said earlier, we feel pretty strongly about our work. We accumulate a stack of possessions and we accumulate a stack of accomplishments. And if you don't think that's true, you take a look at the obituaries we write and see how much we value accomplishment. Now, some of those things are important. They really are. They have their place. And still, there is this banquet, this party to which we are all invited, and God is pretty serious about wanting us to be there. And not just us, everyone. The king invites everyone in the main streets, the good, the bad, everyone, even those whom you might not expect. See, the king makes no distinction. Oh, distinctions, that's what we do. In our design of the world, we have decided who's good and who's not, who's in and who's out. And we can never agree on who's good and who's bad and who's in and who's out, and so we exhaust ourselves trying to make those distinctions. Oh, the brilliance of God's economy in which we're all in. I need to say one more thing about this parable. There's one puzzling detail right at the very end. Remember that when all the folks, the good and the bad from the village square, have been invited into the party and they're all on the dance floor in their party clothes? Do you ever wonder where they got those clothes? They didn't have time to go home and get cleaned up and dressed up, and if they're the poor, they probably didn't have the party clothes anyway. Here's what I think. I think the king opened up his own costume shop. He got his team of tailors together, and he wanted to make sure that everybody who came to that party had the right clothes. Yep. The king himself provided the party clothes for everyone. So there's this one guy walking around the dance floor with his old clothes on. And the king asks him why. Hard to figure out why he wasn't properly dressed when the king himself had provided the clothes. And he's the only guy who gets thrown out of the party. See, here's the most remarkable thing about our life in Christ. God has provided everything we need. In our baptism, we are given the righteousness of Christ. We are covered with Christ's goodness, not our own. It was one of the fundamental teachings of the Reformation, the fundamental teaching of Martin Luther, that we can't do a thing for our own salvation. God has done it all. All we have to do is open our hands to receive the gift. We are all clothed in the mercy of God. The only ones who get kicked out of the party are the ones who are determined that they are going to wear something that they themselves have made of their own design and their own handiwork. The ones who rely on their own works, their own accomplishments. And if we are determined to prove ourselves worthy for the party, then we will feel the sting of many are called, but few are chosen. On the other hand, if we simply open our hands to receive, if we simply revel in the joy of God's grace, if we simply bask in the glow that God's grace alone saves us, then we are not going to worry about bringing our own clothes or about who else God has invited to the banquet, because God has chosen us. And he has chosen everyone else. You know, as I was thinking about this, it reminded me of a hymn from my childhood. I bet I haven't sung it for years. And it's one of those inside verses of that hymn, Rock of Ages, that lays out the profound simplicity of receiving the gift. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. And so, given the clothes of Jesus, a righteousness not of our own doing, we are invited to the heavenly banquet. And in preparation for that feast, the foretaste where the Lamb himself will sit at the head of the table with food and blessing for everyone, the good and the bad, and all who have been clothed in the righteousness of Christ, he invites us to this table, this feast. And as we come forward, as if we are practicing for that final banquet, we open our hands and we receive Christ's very body and Christ's very blood. The gift of faith, the gift of Christ, and the gift of the Spirit. Let us go now to the banquet.